Hello everyone, this video covers sections 2.4 and 2.5. Section 2.4 is about the precise definition of the limit. So by now you already know what limit is, and we're going to make it precise. This section is one of the most theoretical ones of the whole class, so it may look a little weird at the beginning, but this is how you do proofs in calculus, and it will be your first attempt of creating proofs. So this is the formal definition. A function defined on some open interval that contains the number a, except possibly a, and that means the function doesn't have to be defined at a, then we say, so this should be we say, not they, that the limit of f of x as s approaches a is equals to l. So this is the same notation we used before. If for every epsilon bigger than zero, there exists a delta bigger than zero, such as this is the case. All this is telling you is when the distance between x and a is small, the distance between the function and the limit should be small too. That's pretty much all what this means. Now, geometrically, this is what it means. Okay. And this is not new. As x is getting closer and closer to a, you can see that this is getting closer and closer to l, to the limit. So the limit from the left and the limit from the right are the same. So therefore, when the distance, which could be here or could be here, that's why you have the absolute value, then the distance between the function and the value should be small. Or in other words, if the distance between x and a is less than some delta, so this will be the distance, so this is the small, then the distance between f and l, which will be this, will be less than epsilon, or will be small too. Now, this section is going to be very different than the previous ones, because here I will tell you something that is already true, and you will have to show that it is true. And that's a little weird at the beginning, but you'll get used to. And again, this section is very different than everything else we have done and probably that we will do later. But this is an essential part of learning calculus, so everybody has to go through this at least once. All right, so here's the first example. It says prove the statement using epsilon and delta definition of the limit. Now clearly here, if you plug in 3, so 5 times 3 is 15, minus 2 is 13, and this is the case. So this is technically obvious, so most people is, okay, this is true, so what else do we have to do? What is the question? Well, the question is the following. We need to use a definition to show that this is the case. So, but before we do that, let's identify a few things here. Here A, the value for A, where X is approaching A is equals to 5. And here the limit is 13, okay? All right, so this is what we want to do, okay? This is not the proof, and this is why this is also a little confusing. This is what we want is this, okay? We want is that for any epsilon bigger than zero, we need to choose delta bigger than zero also, or positive, such that if the distance between x and a, which in this case is 5, is less than delta, this is positive, then that the distance between f of x, which is 3x minus 2 minus 13, that it should be less than epsilon. Okay, so again, this is what we want. And before we go to the proof, we kind of go backwards. You make a mess first, and then you present the solution, and you usually don't show the mess to anybody. You just show the good solution. This is what I mean. So let's start with this side. Like, so let's go on this side, and let's start with this. So here we have 3x minus 2 minus 13. Notice that this is the same thing as just 3x minus 15. You can factor the 3. So this will be 3 times x minus 5. And this is the same thing as 3, because the absolute value of 3 is 3. And then this is x minus 5. Okay. So now notice that we want this to be less than delta. So that's why we want this part right here. So therefore, if we start there, we also want this to be less than epsilon. Okay, so remember, we want this to be less than epsilon. So this is also what we want. So therefore, if that's what you want, you need to have x minus phi has to be less than epsilon over 3. Okay? And this is the part where we're going to go backwards. Well, if this is less than epsilon over 3, and we need to choose a value for delta, and this has to be less than delta, so maybe this is a very good choice for delta. All right? So again, all of this is the side work that people is not supposed to see, and you never show this to anybody. The actual proof is this. Once you identify the value for alpha, the proof will be the following. You will say this, for any epsilon bigger than 0, choose delta equals to epsilon divided by 3, such that if the distance between x and phi is less than delta, then the distance between f of x, which is 3x minus 2, and L, which is 13, is equals to 3x minus 15. So this is 3 times the absolute value of x minus 5, which we did already. So this is less than 3 times epsilon over 3. You can see that the 3 is canceled, so the only thing you have left is epsilon. And then that's the proof. Now, again, notice that this part, this is the proof. You couldn't have done it without doing this on the side to decide what should be the value for delta. But this, and this is not the proof. This is what you want to do. And it looks like you are going in backwards, and technically you are, but this is the actual proof. So you do this on the side to figure out the value for delta, and once you figure out delta, you're technically done. All right, before we do the second example, which is a little more tricky, let me do another one like the first one. The first one is the easiest one, so you can get more familiarized with this thing. So let's say that I ask you to prove this using the epsilon delta definition. Let's say we have the following. When the limit as x approaches 1 of 4x plus 5. So clearly this is equals to 9. Okay. So therefore what we want, okay, so what we want is this, that for any epsilon bigger than 0, we need to choose delta such that, so I'm going to use this from now on to say such that if the distance between x and a, which in this case a is 1, is less than delta, therefore the distance between f of x and the limit has to be less than epsilon. Okay, so this is what we want. And then we start in here and we say, okay, well, for x minus 4, this you want this to be less than epsilon. Remember, this is what we want. But this, if we factor, this will be 4 times x minus 1 in absolute value. So this is 4 times the absolute value of x minus 1. And since we want this to be less than epsilon, that implies that x minus 1 has to be less than epsilon over 4. So therefore, this is the value we want to choose for delta. And then the actual proof will be like this. Okay, so we will say, so remember, you don't show anybody that part. You only show the good part, and the good part will be this. So this will be the proof. It will say for any epsilon bigger than 0, then you say choose delta to be epsilon over 4 such that if the distance between x and 1 is less than delta, then for x plus 5 minus 1 is equals to for x minus 4, this is equals to 4 times x minus 1, and therefore this is less than 4 times epsilon over 4, which is just equals to epsilon. And that's it. And again, this is the proof. And if the equation is linear, you can see that this and the previous problem were very simple. The next one, the equation is not linear, so things get a little more tricky. But the idea is exactly the same. All right, so therefore here, what we want, again, is this, is the, for any epsilon bigger than 0, we need to choose delta such that if the distance between x and phi is less than delta, that then the distance between f of x and the limit is less than epsilon. So you can see it's the exact same thing that we want. And just like in the other ones, we start with this part. All right, so therefore, we start with this, x squared plus 2x minus a. And remember, this is, we want this. We want it to be less than epsilon. Okay. All right, so we factor this. This is the same thing as x plus 4 times x minus 2. Okay. And for now, you can even forget about this part because that's what you want. Right? But this is equals to this. And notice that, well, first notice that there is a typo. This should be 5. This should be the number 2. So sorry about that. This should be a 2. So therefore, this is equals to the absolute value of x plus 4 times the absolute value of x minus 2, which is this, remember, related to this, just like we did in this problems. The big difference is that now this has a variable, and that messes everything up. If this was just the 4 by itself, this will be identical to this part right here. Okay, to this. Notice how here you have 4 times x minus 1. Well, here you have x in here and x in here. And that complicates things. Now, since we're getting closer and closer to 2 from the right or from the left side, therefore we can assume, okay, and it's not a bad assumption, that the distance between x minus 2 has to be less than 1. Then if we use your pre-calculus skills or algebra 2 skills, from here, this means, remember that minus 1 is less than x minus 2, less than 1. If you add 2 to both sides, this means that 1 is less than x is less than 3. So therefore, that means that the biggest that x can be is 3. Okay, so this is very important. So if the bigger that x can be is 3, therefore, that implies that the biggest that x plus 4 can be is 7. Why is that the case? Well, if the maximum that x can be is 3, well, 3 plus 4 is 7. So this is the biggest that it can get. Therefore, from here, remember that we wanted x plus 4 times x minus 2 to be less than epsilon. Therefore, that means that x minus 2 has to be less than epsilon over 7. Why? Because the maximum that this value can be is now 7. And once you figure this out, you are now like 80% done. Since now we know what's the value for delta. So choose delta equals to this. Okay, so now this is going to be delta. And we can do the proof now. So here is the proof. It's always the same terminology. So we say the following: for any epsilon greater than 0, choose delta to be now the minimum of 1 and epsilon over 7. That's what this means, or the smallest, because remember we start with 1. So you just pick the smallest one of 1 or epsilon over 7. This is 7 out of 4. Such that if the distance between x and 2 is less than delta, then x squared minus 2x or plus 2x minus a is equals to, remember, x plus 4 times x minus 2, but this is less than epsilon. Well, the first one is 7. Remember, we agree that this is less than 7, so this will be less than 7. But this part is less than epsilon over 7. So this will be epsilon over 7. So let me color code this. So this gives you this part. This will give you this part. So therefore, this is less than epsilon. And that's it. That's the proof. So again, this is why this is annoying at the beginning, because the actual proof, and I say this like 4 times already, but it is what it is. So this is the actual proof, but you needed to do all of this on the side to know what should be the value for delta. So this is not the proof, okay? But without this, you can have the problem. The proof is this part. Not this. Now, this can get a lot more tricky if you're especially you're going to limits to infinity or something else, but you only have to worry about linear equations or some polynomials. If you have a polynomial the trick is always going to be the same. So look to the this part, which is should be part of the equation here. We're getting close to 2. Always pick this to be less than 1. In theory, you could use 1/2 or 1/3. But then when you're solving this, it will make it more messy. So that's why we pick 1, because it's the easiest one. And once you figure this out, then that will tell you what should be the maximum value of this part. If you were to have 3 parts here, you will use the same value for x to bound the other 2, if there was another one here. So if it is linear, it's a straightforward, like this one or this one. But if it is quadratic or cubic, you have to use this trick to bound the other terms. And then after that, it's exactly the same as this one or this one. Let's go into section 2.5 now. Here we're going to cover the concept of continuity. So let's start with a definition. A function f is continuous at a number a if the limit as x goes to a of f of x is equals to f of a. Remember that you can have the limit exists without the function existing, okay? So before I talk more about the definition, it should be obvious what continuous is, okay? So you have a graph, especially you have a graph, things are really easy to see. So clearly, let's say this is f of x, and you have the value for a here. You can see that there's nothing wrong with this graph. So this will be f of a, and clearly this function is continuous. But you have a graph that looks like this. It's almost continuous, but you can see that this is discontinuous at this point, okay? So if you have a graph, it's pretty easy to tell if it is continuous or not. But if you have an equation, it may not be that easy to realize it. So therefore, this definition actually implies 3 things. Well, the first one will give you 2 things. This implies that the limit as x approaches a of f of x exists. So you need to have the limit existing. And also you need to have f of a to exist. Now, this one, remember, means that the limit as x approaches a from the left is equals to the limit as x approaches a from the right. So the left and the right limit has to exist for the limit to exist. Now, this only proves that the limit exists. It doesn't mean it's continuous, like here. So you can see that the left limit and the right limit are the same. So therefore, the limit exists. But clearly, this one is not continuous. So to be continuous, you cannot have any holes on it. So this one, the left limit, the right limit are the same. And f of a exists. Well, here, it doesn't exist. Now, let me make a side note that will make life pretty easy later. So polynomials, remember a polynomial looks like this, ax squared plus bx plus c and so forth. Well, that's a quadratic equation, but in general, a polynomial will look like this. So a n x to the n plus a n minus 1 x n minus 1 and so forth until you get to a 0. So these ones, a polynomial is always continuous. And I'm going to use CTS for continuous. Okay, so CTS is going to be continuous from now on. Also, the graph for sine, cosine, these are always continuous, okay? Now, tangent is not always continuous. Okay. And if you have the square root of x, as long as you are in the domain, is continuous. The square root of x, ln of x is continuous, absolute value of x, and so forth. So the most basic functions, most of them are always continuous everywhere. But not everything is continuous, like you can see in here, okay? So therefore, all of these functions, which you should memorize their graphs, see that these are always continuous in their domain. As long as you are in the right domain, everything is continuous. Okay, so this one is not much to worry about. Now, if the function is not continuous, well, it will be discontinuous. And there is technically two types of discontinuity. Type 1 and then type 2. Type 1 is called a removable discontinuity. And removal means you can fix it. So again, let's say that you have an equation that looks like this. Okay. So this function clearly is discontinuous here. So let's say that the function was defined at some point here. So the reason why this is removable, you can technically patch the hole by moving this into here. So if you have this in here, then you destroy the discontinuity, so you could fix this and make it continuous. The second one, it can now be fixed. The second type of discontinuity will be something like this. F of x equals to 1 of x, so the graph looks like this. So this has an asymptote at x equals to 0. So clearly this graph is discontinuous at this point. So therefore this one is discontinuous at x equals to 0, and this one cannot be fixed. Like I just said on the previous page, if you have a graph, it's pretty easy to see if a function is continuous or not, and also if you can fix the discontinuity or not. If they give you the question as a piecewise function, it's a little more tricky, and now you have to check the conditions that we did at the beginning of the page. So now the question says the following: find the value of k that will make the function continuous everywhere. Remember, continuous everywhere means from minus infinity to infinity. Now, this is a polynomial, so this is always continuous, has no issue. This is a linear equation, it's also always continuous, but when you have a piecewise function, things can go wrong. And by that I mean this. This one is a quadratic equation, so it's possible that the graph looks like this, but then the other one looks like this. So clearly they are not continuous. So if you move it to match this one, then they will be continuous. And that's pretty much what the question is asking you. What should be the value of k so that these two graphs match? So as you can see, the issue is only at the point x equals to 4. So if we want it to be continuous, first, we need the limit as x approaches 4 of f of x to exist. So we need this. Okay. Now remember, the limit doesn't exist unless the right limit and the left limit are the same. Therefore, we need to find the left and the right limits and make them equal to each other. Now, the right limit will be this. The limit as x approaches to 4 from the right side of f of x, and you're coming from the right side, that means we're going to use this equation. So therefore, this will be 4k plus 20. So that will be the right limit. Now, the left limit will be the limit as x approaches to 4 from the left of f of x. So now we will need this equation because x is less than 4. So this means coming from the left. So this means you come from the left. If you are not sure, all you have to do is do a number here. So 4 less than or equals to 4 is this. Clearly, this is the left, and clearly, this is the right. All right, so the limit as x approaches to 4 from the left, if we use this equation, this will give us 16 minus k squared. Since we want the limit to exist, that means that the left, which is this one, and the right had to be the same. Therefore, from these two, we have the 16 minus k squared has to equals to 4k plus 20. This will give you a quadratic equation. If you move everything to the right side, you will have 0 is equals to k squared plus 4k and then plus 4. These factors to k plus 2 squared, so that implies the values that of k that will mean this continuous is just k is equals to negative 2. Now the second condition that we need is that we need to have for f of a to exist. So we need this. But a, here, remember the value for a, here a is equals to 4, so that's the part where we may have an issue. And how much is f of 4? F of 4, well, we need to use this one. This will be a 4 squared minus 2 squared, since the value for k is negative 2. And then this will give you 16 minus 4, which is 12. Now, since the limit as x approaches to 4 now is also equals to 12, see, if you put minus 2 here, minus 2 times 4 is minus 8, plus 20 is equals to 12, so that checks. And in the other side, we already saw that we got 12. So therefore, condition 1 is satisfied, condition 2 are satisfied. So that implies that f of x is continuous everywhere if k is equals to negative 2. All right, so just to recap, a function will be continuous if the limit exists, which implies that the left and the right limits have to exist also and be the same. And also if the function exists at that given point. Because remember, you can have the limit existing without the function existing at all. All right, so the next theorem is just an extension of continuity. So this is another theorem, and it says the following. If f is continuous at B, so remember what that means. This part means that the limit as x approaches B of f of x is equals to f of B. That's what it means. And if the limit as x approaches b of g of x is equals to b, so this is another function, then the limit of the composition is just equals to f of b. Now, in other words, or written in a different way, this implies that the limit as x approaches a of the composition of f and g is equals to f times the limit as x approaches a of g of x. This is a very important definition, but this assumes that the function is continuous. If the function is not continuous, this is not the case, okay? And many times people use this limit because it will be easier to use, even though one doesn't apply. And I'll give you an example of that in a little bit. First, let me give you an example where actually works. An example. Here, let's say that f of x equals to x to the 4, and g of x is equals to x cubed minus 2x. So therefore, if we have this information, then from here, the limit as x approaches, let's say, 2 of g of x, clearly this will be 2 cubed minus 2 times 2, which is equals to 4. Therefore, the limit as x approaches 2 of f composition with g of x will be just equals to f of the limit as x approaches 2 of g of x, which in our case will be f of 4, but f of 4 will just be 4 to the 4 power, which is equals to 256, and that's it. Now, you have to be very careful when you use this definition, because if the function is not continuous, if function f is not continuous, you may get something that doesn't even exist, but you will get a solution, for example. So keep in mind this example. Let's say that here f of x is equals to 1 over x, and g of x is equals to 1 over x squared. Remember that the limit as x approaches 0 of f of x does not exist. Okay, we have done that before. Remember the graph for f of x equals to 1 over x looks like this. So this is an unfixable discontinuity. Remember, the limit doesn't exist when x approaches 0. So this is not continuous at 0. Okay. But look at what happens next. But if you do f composition g, this will be 1 over x squared, which just will give you x squared. So therefore, if we do it that way, if I ask it what's the limit as x approaches 0 of f of g of x, and then we say, well, this is equals to the limit as x approaches to 0 of x squared, which is equals to 0. This is completely wrong. This is not true, because if the limit didn't exist here, this will not exist either. So you just have to be careful with this, that you make sure that f is continuous. If f is not continuous, this is not the case. I mean, you will get something, but it will be meaningless. All right? The last thing we're going to cover is the intermediate value theorem. This theorem is going to be used extensively in calculus 2, calculus 3, differential equations, higher math. If you are a math major, this is a very important theorem. And it's very, very simple what it says. So what it says is the following. Now that you know what a continuous function is, this is what the intermediate value theorem says. Let's say you go from A to B, Yeah, you have a function that is continuous there between a and the value b. Okay, so this is continuous between a and b. And clearly, well, this is f of b, and obviously this is f of a. Okay. So what the intermediate value theorem says is the following, that if f of a is less than some number n, less than some b, that there exists a number c that will be between a and b, such that f of c will be equals to n. So therefore, if n is here, let's say this is n, then there is a value between a and b that will give you that value. So this is kind of obvious, because see, you have a function and it's continuous. Remember, by the way, continuous means that you start here without lifting your pen, you can keep drawing. So if you got to the number n, and you do the same thing here, well, at some point, find a value that matches with that number. And the value will be c, and this is between these two. Now, in higher math classes, and also in calculus, the intermediate value theorem is usually used to show that you have a solution or a root. Remember what, recall what root of an equation is. So you have, for example, x squared minus x minus 12 equals to 0, or you can factor this as x minus 4 and x plus 3. So the zeros or their roots are 4 and negative 3. So these are the roots or the zeros of the solution. Okay? All right, so let me do a different example to show you how this works. Let's say that you have the following equation. Let's say that f of x is equals to x squared minus 4. Okay? If we graph this, the graph looks like this. Okay, so obviously this one has two roots, okay? So let's say that you wanted to show that there is a root between here and here. So let's say this is 1 and this is the number 3. Okay. Notice that the function is continuous. That's the big deal here. So f of 1, notice that f of 1 is 1 squared minus 4, which is equals to negative 3. So this is a negative value. But f of 3, this will give you 3 squared minus 4, which is 5. And this is a positive value. So therefore, when x was 1, you get a negative value, which is right here. And when x is 3, you get a positive value, which is here. All right, so if you go from negative to positive, there has to be a value between 1 and 3, where this has to be equals to 0, which will be the root. So therefore, what you say is the following. So therefore, by the intermediate value theorem, there exists a number c, where c is between 1 and 3, such that f of c will be equals to 0. This is not asking you what is the solution, just to show that there is a solution. And it's going to be used a lot later in the class. So just remember this intermediate value theorem. And I think that's it for section 2.4 and 2.5.